Hello again and welcome to this next video in the Yi 2 series. And in this video we're going to be looking at rules and validation that you will find in the models inside Yi. Some rules are created by default from the database information, but most of the rules you will have to create and modify yourself. And there's two reasons why we want to use validation rules in Yi. One of them is perhaps an obvious one, which is security. And although the system itself is quite secure by default, rather than allowing users to type any kind of data into any type of field, which could cause security problems, by having certain validation rules on that data, we can avoid some of those security problems happening in the first place, such as attempts to create SQL injection attacks, and things like that. The second reason why validation rules are important is to keep the data in our system clean. And the reason that's important is because if the data is not as it's expected, then it can cause problems for us as the system maintainer later on. So imagine if you had a field for email address and somebody typed in data incorrectly and perhaps typed just their name into that box instead. Then later on, when your system attempts to send an email to that value, to that address, it's probably going to crash in some way, and that's not really what you want. So by validating these things before they get saved to the database, then you help with the system itself being more secure. And of course, there are many other ways in which incorrect data could make your system crash. And so there are a whole range of validators that are used for it. So in terms of the Yi lifecycle, if we're looking here at the book controller, which we've already seen in our previous videos, and this is the default code for the update action in the book controller. And you'll see that it's fairly simple, that in terms of updating, it will first find the existing model, and then it does two things. The first of these is to copy all of the data from the post variable, and that is the data that the user typed into their form, and copies that over into the model that it's just created by finding the existing one from the database. And then once that happens, the second thing that happens is it calls model save, and by default, save also runs validation rules. And only if those validation rules succeed will model save return true, which will then call this piece of code, which will redirect to the view action for that model. And if that returns false, if the validation fails, then instead it will go back to the same view for update and allow the user to correct those errors. So what actually happens when you run validation is for the model in question, the rules function is used to return an array, and this array contains a whole set of data validation rules. And we're going to look at most of these in this video and explain roughly what each of them are. And it's worth remembering that not all of these validators are actually data validators, which might be confusing. Some of them perform other purposes, and we'll look at those as we go through. So when we have validators, they all inherit from a base class, and there are some common properties which are used in virtually all of the validators. Things like the not property allows you to invert the logic in some of the validators. So if you have, for instance, a range validator, you could say that I don't want the data to be in this range, or you could say I do want it to be in that range. You can also override the message property to set your own message if the default message is not useful enough. And you've also got things like skip on empty, which allows you to say if the data's not actually filled in, do I still want to validate it or not? And in some cases you will, in some cases you won't. Another property that we will mention later is enable client validation. And that specifies whether JavaScript code is created by this validator and put into your views automatically. And again, usually we would want client validation, but I have found one scenario recently where that doesn't work and I had to disable it. And we'll talk about that later. So if we go through the rules that we've specified here in our book model, these first five lines are the rules that were already in this model. And then what I've done is I've created a load of fake rules here just to demonstrate some of the other things that we can do with Yi validation. So the first one should be fairly obvious. This rule is the required validator. And the required validator, as you might imagine, just says that there must be a value for these fields. And one thing that's worth noting at this stage is you can specify a number of fields using an array, or you can specify a single field in an array, as this rule does. Or if you just have a single field that's outside of an array, then obviously the rule will only apply to that one field. So we could have this as two lines if we wanted to. We could have one line for title and one for description. And that really depends on what you would prefer. If you have a larger model, it's sometimes nicer to group the validators by property. So sometimes it's easier to do that. But if it's a small model, you might just want to put them all on one line. So the second one, you can use this in two ways. There's one called integer and there's also one called double. And they both actually refer to the same validator. And that validator allows you, first of all, to check that the type is integer, if strict is turned on. Also that the value of this property, in this case author ID, is actually a number. And you can even specify the regular expression to use to actually check that number. There is a default one set for integer and for double. You can override it if you like, and you can also set things like minimum and maximum using additional properties. This next line is the string validator, but what needs to be mentioned here is that the string validator is not validating that the data is a string, because actually all data here is a string. It's all coming in from a post variable. So what this is actually doing is it's allowing us, the developer, to specify the min and maximum length for that string. And these will be filled in automatically by Yi when you generate these models if you have lengths specified in your database table. Even if you have, you might want this to be more strict. So you might say, well, actually, we only allow 32, even if the database says 64. So clearly, you could set those separately if you wanted to. And then the description ISBN are just exactly the same as the string ones. So if we now look down here, these are my pretend rules that I've created. This is just a required rule, but this demonstrates the use of on. Now, on allows you to specify scenarios, and it's worth briefly talking about scenarios in Yi, because they allow you to say which scenarios these rules apply to. So when you create a model, by default, there is only one scenario and it's called default. And if you don't ever specify it anywhere, there is only ever one scenario. The problem with that is if you have something like, say, a password field, and you use this same model in lots of different places, you don't always necessarily want the password field to be required. You might say, actually, I only want a password required when they're creating a book, but at any other time that I'm using this model, that password is not required. So by specifying this word in here, you're automatically adding a scenario to the list of possible scenarios in this model. You can create as many as you like, you can call them whatever you like, but what this allows you to do is create some quite complicated business logic. And then when you create your book model or any other model, you have the ability to pass in that scenario as one of the constructor arguments to enable you to say we are using the create scenario. And that would look something like this. Model, find model, we would pass in as an array of options, scenario, and that would be, say, create. So we could do it like that. We could also, to delete that. We could also do $model arrow scenario equals create. So we could do that as well. And specifying that scenario just enables and disables certain validation. So that should be fairly self-explanatory. An alternative to on, the opposite if you like, is except. And that enables you to say, this is required in all scenarios except the one I specify. And obviously, depending on how many scenarios you have, one or the other might be more useful. This second one here is just demonstrates the use of in, and it's like SQL in. So it's saying that the value inside this property role needs to be one of these. And again, you can use not in this rule if you would like. You could do that and you could say not arrow true. And again, this would invert the logic in this case and say role can be anything, but it's not allowed to be the value user or admin. Perhaps not a great example. And now we're going to look at the compare validator. And as you might imagine, what you're doing with the compare validator is saying that this property, in this case password, either needs to match another property or the value of another property, or it needs to match a hard-coded value. And that depends whether you set the compare attribute or the compare value to whatever it is you're checking. Now, one of the things that you've got to be careful of with the compare rule is that it can do some automatic wiring up. So what happens is if you don't specify compare attribute or compare value, the rule will automatically set compare attribute to be that word plus underscore repeat. So effectively, that rule is the same as that rule, but the first one is wired up automatically, the second one is wired up explicitly. Now you can see their logic by saying, particularly for things like passwords, you have a password property, you have a password repeat property. The problem with this is if you created that rule for your password, then if they typed the wrong password into password repeat, the error message would actually appear next to the password field. And that might not be what you want, because usually you want the error to be next to the password repeat field, in which case an alternative, instead of creating either of these rules, we actually create the rule against password repeat and we tell it to compare it to the value of password. And in this case, we're also demonstrating how we can set up our own custom message using the translation of ye colon colon t, the category of app, and then the message that we want to display if it's in English. The next one I want to demonstrate is the match validator. And match is basically a regular expression. And the regular expression you specify using pattern. And although you can specify whatever you like in here, one of the things that I found out the other day on another project was that when you have enable client validation set to true, which it is by default, then it creates you the same regular expression but using JavaScript. Now, as it happens, backslash capital X, which is a Unicode escape character for any Unicode character, doesn't actually work in JavaScript. So if you have client validation enabled, then the validation never works in JavaScript. It will always tell you that the value is invalid, even if it's correct. So here's an example of where you might want to set client validation to false. And then what happens is your page has to post back to the server to then do the validation and then come back and say whether the data is or isn't allowed. The next one is a unique validator. And as you might imagine, this is very common for things like usernames. And what it's basically saying is using this data class, make sure that the value in username is unique. If you don't specify the target attribute, it will just use the same attribute. So it'll look up the property username in the user model and make sure that there isn't one already called username. which is fairly straightforward. The opposite of that is exists. And exists, it does a very similar thing, but it's checking that the value you've typed in does exist already, rather than doesn't exist. And so now we're going to look at some of the other non-validators, or in terms of filters. The idea of the filter is that rather than being a validation, it's effectively an operation that can be carried out on your data before it's saved to the database. So as you might guess from this filter, this trim is just a white space trim. It cuts off any leading or trailing spaces, and it's very useful, but it's not actually validating the data, it's just modifying it. And you can create your own filters, again, to do anything that you might want to do, like capitalizing it or changing everything to lowercase or whatever. Another email validator, that is, an email is just a normal validator, and it's really a shorthand for having a match validator with a regular expression that matches an email. So again, that just ensures that people type in an email into the email field. There are now a couple, again, of non-validation validators, if you like. And I'm not really sure why they've been created as validators. But the first one's called default. And all this does is allows you to provide a default value for any data that's empty. So if the user hasn't typed a country, then we're saying that the default value for that is United States. Clearly, that's kind of like a filter, and it will run just before you save the data, so it kind of works, but default isn't actually a validator, so don't get confused. And then the last one that I want to look at is this thing called safe. Now, what you need to understand in the way that that Yi works is, if we go back to our controller, where this is called model load, then what actually happens is Yi goes through, finds every piece of data in the post, so that is the content of any field that was posted back in the form, and then tries to match it up to every field in the model. Now, when we look at the views, we will see that the name of the text edit fields that you're using in the view match the names of these properties. So clearly, if you have a field coming back in the form called description, then Yi guesses that that description belongs in this property, and it assigns all of that across. And Yi calls that massive assignment. And obviously massive assignment is very useful, and it's a very easy way of being able to wire up forms to models without having to explicitly wire up every single edit field that you add to your forms. Now, the problem with that is, how do you know if you want that data assigned across or not? So for instance, because this is done automatically on properties, in my case, this book extends active record. An active record has various properties built in, like primary key name and things like that. Now, clearly, primary key name is nothing to do with what I'm using this model for. And what I wouldn't want to happen is for an attacker to add a field into a form called primary key and then to submit that form to the action, this update action, and have Yi automatically assign the new value for primary key into my model and then to save it. And so the way that Yi gets around that is it says, well, if your property doesn't appear in any of these rules, then I'm not going to massively assign it. So if you added a field called primary key and you try to assign it, Yi would just say no, because there is no validation rule here. And that is where safe comes in, because if you have a property that is not required and has no other data validation applied to it, then how else are you able to tell Yi that you still want that value to be assigned without having some kind of validator, which is what safe is? So it doesn't actually do anything. All it does is it signals to Yi that I do want this value to be copied from the form, but anything else that doesn't appear in any of these other rules will not be assigned. And then after that all happens and all the validators have run, assuming that they succeed, then the rest of this function here, model save, will then go and update the database or create a new item in the database if this is a new item. So hopefully you've got a pretty good idea now of how these validators work. One of the things that I would suggest is that you test and test again, because especially with things like regular expressions, but even with these other validators, you need to think very carefully about what you're validating, how you're going to validate it. You're going to have to realize that in most cases, you're not going to be able to test for 100% of all the types of bad data that could be typed in. And you need to know how you're then going to deal with that. You also need to decide, are you going to allow empty text in some of these fields or not? And again, work out how you're going to deal with those kinds of things. But sometimes these validators won't do exactly what you expect. So you really do need to test them before you commit to using them. And then just make sure that your model is as solid as you can make it. So I look forward to seeing you in the next video. And any questions or comments, please just add them to the comment section below.